Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Ed Jurgen, the founding director of the Baker Institute. We're delighted to have you here this evening for what has become a very noted stream of authors who present their books at the Baker Institute that goes back to the origins of our institute. So I welcome you to tonight's event. Our most recent authors have been here. In April, we had former Mayor Bill White, who discussed U.S. fiscal policy in his new book. And last week, Shadi Hamid of Brookings Institution delivered a talk on his book about the Arab Spring and the role of Islamist parties in the future of the Middle East. Tonight, we're delighted to have my good friend. He has a title called Ambassador, but he prefers that his friends call him by his first name, Sir. But in any case, we have, I could go on, Chase, on it. We have Ambassador Chase Untermeyer here. It's my pleasure to welcome to the podium my right hand here, Dr. Alan Matiso, who's our academic director at the Baker Institute, who happens to be himself a presidential historian. Don't get any ideas, Chase. But he will introduce our speaker tonight, Alan.
It's indeed a pleasure to welcome Ambassador Untermeyer to the podium today. He is, as I think everybody in this room knows, one of the most distinguished citizens of our city, and he has had a great career in politics and in public service. He has a fascinating. If you really want to find out about Ambassador Untermeyer, he gave a wonderful interview to the Miller Center for the Study of the Presidency. It's on the web, and you can learn many fascinating things about him. As for example, he began his political career while he was at Spring Branch High School at the age of 15, volunteering for the campaign of Tower for U.S. Senate. That was a very important campaign because it broke the monopoly of the Democratic Party on elective offices in the state. And I don't know that Senator Tower ever attributed his victory to the ambassador, but for this occasion, why not? In 1966, George Bush ran for Congress in a newly created congressional district in West Houston, and Ambassador Untermeyer was a student of at Harvard, and he spent his summer vacation working for George Bush. They gave him usual boring things to do, and he suggested to one of the people who were managing the campaign that, you know, he could actually do research. So they gave him the job of researching the public career of Frank Briscoe, who was the opponent of George Bush in that campaign. And he wrote a report and then gets a phone call from Mr. Bush saying this was great and asking him to spend the rest of his summer vacation, a few weeks working with Bush in Bush's own office, right? And there he did valuable work, and at the end, Bush says, you ever want to be an intern, you got it. And he spent the summer of 67 as an intern for then Congressman Bush. In 1968, Ambassador Untermeyer was graduating from Harvard, and George Bush was a second year congressman, and in that year, maybe the most divisive issue was federal legislation for open housing. That is to end, in certain limited ways anyway, discrimination in the sale of housing. And at the age of 22, Ambassador Untermeyer wrote a letter to Congressman Bush recommending that he vote for that act. It says a lot about who Chase Untermeyer is. And it also tells you a lot about Congressman Bush that he took the advice and voted for that. It must have been one of the hardest decisions that Congressman Bush ever made. And later he gave credit to Chase Untermeyer for helping him come to that conclusion. Ambassador Untermeyer spent 2 years in the Navy in the early 70s, stationed in the Pacific during the Vietnam War, 3 years as a Chronicle reporter, and then began his own political career from 77 until 81. He was a two-term member of the Texas legislature. And in 1980, he ran for a third term, but it also happened to be the year that George Bush ran for president. Fortunately, his opponent was Ronald Reagan, and he was out of it by May. Ambassador Untermeyer volunteered for that campaign. Of course, Bush became the vice president. And he then appointed Ambassador Untermeyer as executive assistant in the White House. And there, Ambassador Untermeyer spent two exciting years. He then was appointed as an assistant secretary of the Navy. He served in that capacity until 1988. And that was the year that Vice President Bush ran and successfully for the presidency. And while he was running, Ambassador Untermeyer began quietly to arrange the transition, a tremendously important assignment. And when Bush won and had his first news conference down here at the George Brown Convention Center, he announced three appointments. One was that James A. Baker III would be his Secretary of State, and that Chase Untermeyer would be the man in charge of personnel. That is, he would have to fill or try to advise the president on filling the positions in the government that were presidential appointments. He did that for 2 years. He then spent the next 2 years of the administration as director of the Voice of America. Then Bush lost. And I don't know whether Ambassador Untermeyer thought that he was out in the wilderness or not, but he was, at least politically. And in the next several years of the 90s, he worked for Compaq. He was in charge of governmental relations there. He was also had a high position at the Texas Medical Center. And then in 2004, he received an appointment as the ambassador to Qatar. And he was there for nearly 4 years. These were exciting and important years, and they had to be the highlight of this distinguished career. When he ended his ambassadorship, Ambassador Untermeyer came back and has been active in business since then. This is his public career. That is his political career. But to me, one of the most remarkable features of this career is the number of voluntary civic activities that he's engaged in. Just to give you a sample of some of them over the last 20 years, board of directors of the National Public Radio, a member of the Houston Port Commission, president of the Houston Reed Commission, chairman of the Board of Visitors of the U.S. Naval Academy, a member of the State Board of Education, the chairman of the board of St. Luke's Episcopal Health Charities, and the list, it keeps going. It's an extraordinary list of civic service. Turns out that he kept a diary from 1956, and the way I subtract, you were 10 years old.
Nine.
9 years old. I could hardly write when I was nine. 250 volumes into it, he decided to take a chunk of it and publish it. He took the chunk that was his 2 years as the executive assistant to Vice President Bush, 81 and 82. And he published those diary entries, or many of them, in this book called When Things Went Right, published by Texas A&M Press, 2013. Well, I've been reading this book, and I've enjoyed it tremendously. It's a book about a young man going to Washington. It's a book about the exciting beginning of the Reagan administration. It's about his travels with George Bush. It's not about high policy. What it does is give you the feel of Washington in those days and what it meant to be close to the action. As it turns out, Ambassador Untermeyer is a very good writer and tells a great story. What comes through in this book to me is Ambassador Untermeyer himself. He is, in his own diary, modest. He's a master of self-deprecating humor. He is generous in his estimation of others. And I came to believe at the end of this book that anybody who went to those endless Washington dinner parties and had Ambassador Untermeyer as a companion was very fortunate indeed. This book is going to be on sale outside, and Ambassador Untermeyer is going to sell or sign these books. Nobody asked me to endorse this book, but my advice is go buy it. Ambassador Untermeyer.
Well, thank you, Professor Matuso, to be introduced by such a distinguished American historian in those terms is very flattering. I think we should just stop here. It will also help us to forget what Ambassador Derejian had to say earlier. I answer to any title. In our former lives, we were often called Your Excellency, which is very common overseas. However, to American ears, it sounds faintly ridiculous. As illustrated by a scene in one of my favorite movies, Duck Soup, with Groucho Marx and his brothers, in which Groucho plays the president of a small country called Fredonia. And at his grand entrance at the ball that begins the movie, Mrs. Teasdale, played by Margaret Dumont, always the battleship-shaped woman who was in the Marx Brothers movies, bows very low and says, "Your Excellency." And Groucho takes out his cigar, looks at her, and says, "You ain't so bad yourself." So Ambassador Derejian is in that mode. And I am grateful to him for the chance to be at this very distinguished podium and talk a little bit about this book. Now, as Professor Matuso was so kind to say, this is based upon a personal journal. And it is a journal I've been keeping since the age of 9. The business of being a journal keeper is quite rare in our times, although it used to be much more common in our nation's history. And as such, I would like to just take a walk back through history in the business of keeping a journal. John Quincy Adams, when he was no longer president but a congressman from Massachusetts, wrote in his journal on the 20th of July, 1834, after noting that he had spent the previous night copying into his letter book a letter to his wife. In those days, if you wanted to keep a copy of your letters, you had to write it again, put it in your letter book. And he said, "This is noisome and to me useless labor, consuming time which might be fruitfully employed. But in my father's first letter book, I find him saying on the 2nd of June, 1776, that in all the correspondence he had maintained over 20 years, he had never kept a single copy of any of his letters. And he adds, this negligence and inaccuracy had been a great misfortune to him on many occasions. A letter book, a diary, a book of receipts and expenses, these three books kept without intermission should be the rule of every man who can read and write. But to keep them perseveringly requires a character given to very few of the sons of men. Above all, it requires a character to which toil is a pleasure and of which untiring patience is an essential element." Well, guilty as charged. Hilaire Belloc, the British essayist, poet, and satirist, asked, "Why are there so few diaries?" "Because mankind, and even womankind, lacks the industry required. Most people have enough routine in their lives and certainly enough leisure to keep up the daily entries, but they have not the tenacity sufficient to keep abreast of the work. For one thing, there is no money in it. And yet, I suppose every man who has lived a long life, especially if it be a half-public sort, regrets the lack of a diary." And back to John Quincy Adams, who was still struggling with his daily work, he said, "Had I spent upon any work of science or literature the time employed in this diary, it might perhaps have been permanently useful to my children and my country." as only Diana could agree, I think. Now, in modern times, keeping a journal while in public office is more risky than noisome. There are those very curious special prosecutors who get appointed from time to time who might throw out a subpoena, which I'm glad to say never hit me. And even more so, there are nervous bosses who are anxious to see how they might be portrayed. For example, Margaret Thatcher, who wrote that she said to her cabinet soon after becoming prime minister that, "I had no intention of keeping a diary of cabinet discussions, and I hope that others would follow my example. Inconvenient as that may be for the authors of memoirs, it is the only satisfactory rule for governments." I'm grateful that George Bush didn't seem to mind too much that I was keeping a journal during all those years. Now, for some reason, Charles Dickens was very offended by diaries, and he made a point of putting into Nicholas Nickleby the following. He said, "Some of the craftiest scoundrels that ever walked this earth, or rather, for walking implies at least an erect position and the bearing of a man, that ever crawled and crept through life by its dirtiest and narrowest ways, will gravely jot down in diaries the events of every day and keep a regular debtor and creditor account with heaven, which shall always show a floating balance in their own favor." Well, I ran these risks of keeping a journal simply because by that time, in 1981, it was a part of my life. And I would have spent January of 1981 and the subsequent months and years writing about what I did every day, whether my work site was the White House or the Texas House. And as Professor Matuso said, this then, this book, When Things Went Right, is the story of that very dramatic change in my life. But as much as possible, I've tried to keep myself out of this book, which is a challenge in a personal journal, because I did not want to be the central character, only a character. So instead of telling fond White House anecdotes, which are there aplenty, my aim was indeed to capture the drama, the mood, and above all, the personalities of that time. Now, this evening in this eminent Institute of Public Policy, I want to touch on two historical themes that are found in this book. The first is the development of the modern vice presidency. When George Bush went to Washington in January of 1981, and I was soon to follow, there was somebody particularly anxious for his success. And it was an unusual person to be anxious because he was the defeated Democratic vice president, Walter Mondale. Mondale should be given great historic credit as the pioneer of the modern vice presidency. You may remember that in 1976, when Jimmy Carter was about to become the nominee of the Democratic Party, he interviewed various people to be his running mate, among them Mondale. And when he did select Mondale, Mondale was inclined to accept, but he wanted to strike a deal. And the deal was that Mondale would accept the nomination for vice president only upon the assurance that if Carter and he were elected in November, that there would be four features of his time as vice president that Carter would have to agree to. The first would be that the vice president would have an office in the West Wing of the White House. Historically, vice presidents, who of course are the president of the Senate, had an office only on the Capitol. And it was, in fact, Lyndon Johnson, who was the first vice president to have an office in the White House complex. But significantly, his office was not in the White House proper, but in what is called the old executive office building next door. So Mondale believed, very importantly, in the rule of real estate that location, location, location matters, and that to be a figure of consequence in the world of the White House, you must be in the West Wing. And as a result, that was one of his irreducible demands. The second was that all the paperwork that was sent to the president in the form of intelligence or policy proposals would also come to the vice president so that the vice president would know what was going on. The third was that any meeting on the president's schedule, except those of a very personal nature, the vice president had a standing invitation also to attend. And the fourth was that if all failed, that the president and the vice president would have a private lunch at least once a week with no one present, just so the vice president could talk to the president. Now, this was agreed to by Mondale, and I have to tell you that it has been agreed to by every pair of presidents and vice presidents of both parties ever since. I contend that it's one of the major developments in the governance of the United States that is completely informal. It's not an act of Congress. It's not in the Constitution. It's strictly an agreement by the president toward the vice president. Now, seen from our time, when very recently Dick Cheney was such a very powerful commanding vice president, these things that Mondale asked for, the office, the paperwork, the meetings, and the lunch, seem very quaint. They even seem sort of obvious. Of course, you'd expect the vice president to be present at meetings, and of course, to have a chance to make known his opinion to the president. But that was not the case as of 1976. The vice president at the time was the great Nelson Rockefeller. At least he had been great until he was made vice president. And then he was marginalized and truly humiliated by a couple of White House chiefs of staff by the name of Rumsfeld and Cheney. And they made sure that this man who had been the master of New York state politics, and by the way, scion of the most powerful family in America, had no authority whatsoever as vice president. And that was a very sad ending to Rockefeller's very long and distinguished public career. Well, this was clearly known by Walter Mondale, and he wanted to avoid becoming the Rockefeller of the Carter administration. And that's indeed how he established the modern vice presidency. 4 years later, along comes George Bush, who had not only been selected as vice president, he has selected after opposing Reagan in the Republican primaries. So if there was going to be any counterattack by the Reagan staff against the vice president, it was probably likelier with somebody who had opposed Reagan in the Republican primaries as anyone else. So Mondale and his staff were deeply concerned that that not happen, that the institution that they pioneered could be maintained. That's the reason why when I was selected to be executive assistant to vice president, I was called down to Washington. First chance to walk into the West Wing of the White House and spend any time there was at the very end of the Carter administration, because the Mondale staff very much wanted to transfer, not just to me, but to some of my other colleagues, the essence of how they felt a vice president could make himself relevant in the world of the White House. This was aided by an event that was completely unplanned and certainly off anybody's briefing paper, and that was the attempted assassination of President Reagan scarcely 10 weeks into the administration. Up until that time, I can say, speaking for myself, I don't think Vice President Bush felt this, but there was a great deal of coldness and hostility at the staff level in the White House toward those of us who had not supported Ronald Reagan for president, but had in fact supported his primary opponent. That all ended on March 30th, 1981, when George Bush, completely as a result of his own values, his upbringing, his sense of propriety, his knowledge of American history, acted the way he did as the fill-in for the wounded Reagan. The Reagan staff, I'm not sure what they imagined, but I think they thought it was eminently to Bush's credit that he didn't occupy the Oval Office, that he didn't take the president's chair in the cabinet room, and that he did not land his helicopter on the South Lawn of the White House. All these things never entered George Bush's mind, and specifically, I happened to be there on Air Force Two when he made the decision against the recommendation of the Secret Service and the military aide to do exactly that, for security reasons, land on the South Lawn of the White House. He said, Bush said, that that's only for the president. And besides, he knew that Nancy Reagan was deeply distraught, and the noise of the helicopter landing just outside her bedroom would have been the last thing that she needed at that particular time. Well, as I said, none of this should have been a surprise, but it was an immensely impressive development to the Reagan staff. And from that point, they considered Bush a full, loyal member of the team, as indeed he was. But that did so much more than anything planned to create that atmosphere and make it possible for Bush to continue in that role throughout his vice presidency. That is the first theme I wanted to talk about, how, and this book describes, the development of the modern vice presidency was secured in the time of Reagan and Bush. The second thing I'd like to do is to correct a modern misreading of Ronald Reagan and of Reaganism. Now, Ronald Reagan was famously dedicated to conservative principles, and he saw it as the bedrock on which government policy should be erected. He did not view that structure as completely made of rock, the way some building in Petra would be, in which every lintel, every doorway, every beam was made of rock. The bedrock was there. The structure, well, you could make it out of other materials as needed in order to create a structure. This may explain why there are very few buildings made of rock outside of Petra. And so, in order to move his agenda, Ronald Reagan never hesitated to make compromises as required in order to get a bill through Congress. He never hesitated to meet with the opposition, most famously with Tip O'Neill. And as a result, he won his great successes in the Congress. Now today, what Reagan did, meeting with the opposition, making compromises, is considered by many in my party to be a betrayal of principle. Well, Ronald Reagan was never a betrayer of his own principles. He just was very effective at making compromises when compromises were due. When he did, his staunchest supporters either couldn't discern what the president was doing, or they couldn't bring themselves around to blaming him. So what did they do? Well, they blamed Jim Baker and George Bush. Jim Watt, who was the Secretary of the Interior at the start of the Reagan administration, very famously said, with Jim Baker sitting just a few feet away, "Let Reagan be Reagan." And what that meant was, or intimated, was that there were evil forces within the White House, such as the Chief of Staff, who were keeping Ronald Reagan from being true to his principle and who were turning him aside from the way or the paths that he would normally travel if it weren't for their noxious influence. Well, this argument, which was picked up by many others, always seemed very odd to me because the nature of that line of thinking would be to make these people who considered themselves the president's staunchest supporters say the same thing as the president's fiercest foes, namely that Ronald Reagan was just a witless actor who recited lines that others had written for him. The late Clymer Wright, who was a conservative activist here in Houston, wrote an open letter accusing Jim Baker of undermining and sabotaging Reagan's program. For this, Ronald Reagan took out paper and immediately wrote back to Clymer, and he said, "Yes, there is undermining of my efforts going on, and yes, there is sabotage of what I'm trying to accomplish, but it's being done by the people who write these articles and columns, not by any White House staff member, and certainly not Jim Baker. I'm in charge, and my people are helping to carry out the policies I set. No, we don't get everything we want, and yes, we have to compromise to get 75 or 80% of our program." Another thing that Ronald Reagan believed in that I believe his announced supporters of today either don't know or choose not to recognize is that Reagan had a great belief in competence, the ability of people in order to get his policies enacted and to carry them out once they were passed by the Congress. He did not see any conflict between competent, experience in government and conservative principle. Once again, we turn to Jim Baker as the best example of this. Many staunch Reaganites were horrified when Ronald Reagan chose Jim Baker, who had been the campaign manager of Gerald Ford and George Bush, Reagan's great opponents on his way to the White House, to be the White House Chief of Staff. But Ronald Reagan recognized the innate political skills and administrative ability of James Baker, and indeed, it was James Baker who got the programs of Ronald Reagan through the Congress by organizing the very detailed legislative effort that week in, week out of very hard labor did achieve the president's goals. And it wasn't just Jim Baker, of course. He also felt that George Bush, his former opponent, had great skills, especially in the national security, international relations sphere that could be brought to bear and were brought to bear. and throughout the Reagan administration were other people of great competence and prior federal experience, like Caspar Weinberger and George Shultz, who were put to great use in carrying out the Reagan program. Unfortunately, today, to have been even inside the borders of the District of Columbia is considered to be part of the reason that government is in trouble, that you are somehow complicit in all that is wrong with American government simply by having been there. And there is a notion, therefore, that not having had any experience in national government is desirable, because those people would be untainted by the actual business of trying to build that structure on the bedrock of conservative principle. This is wrong, and I'd like to think I could say that if I myself didn't have prior experience, but I got to say that there is no better way to understand the mechanism which is necessary in order to carry out a president's program than having been in the bureaucracy, by having actually worked with civil servants rather than just talk about them over the lecture circuit, of actually working with the Congress and dealing with congressional staff and making that testimony, as opposed to just believing that by giving a brilliant piece of oratory that everyone will fall down in awe and vote for that program. The actual business of government is definitely science and a form of art. And you simply cannot imagine that walking into office is the way to get it done. Certainly, a president of the United States needs those leadership skills that come from executive experience, as did Ronald Reagan and George Bush, George W. Bush, and for that matter, Jimmy Carter or a Bill Clinton, who had been governors of states before they took office. I do believe that one day we will be blessed to have another president who has the principles, the skills, and the experience of a Ronald Reagan or a George Bush. And then we shall once more have an era in Washington when things go right. Thank you all very much for your time this evening. And I'll be happy to answer any questions or stimulate any discussion that you all may have on that. Otherwise, we'll have to just go sign books. Yes, sir.
What prompted you to advise George Bush to vote for the open housing legislation?
Yes, well, you may remember that that took place immediately after the assassination of Martin Luther King in April of 1968. It was a time of great strain and emotion in the country. I was, at that particular time, I believe, in Washington just because it was spring break. And I'd been doing the sort of things I did whenever I could get away from college and go down to Washington, namely answering letters and answering the phone. But I did feel motivated that this was an important time, recognizing that the symbolism would be as important as the actual legislation, that George Bush, who had campaigned for the U.S. Senate in 1964 as an opponent to the Civil Rights Act of 1964, would do well to make a statement of his heart, his principles, which were always very open, friendly, and understanding of black Americans. At the time, during the Vietnam War, there were many black Americans or people of color in general in uniform, and he felt that it would be a betrayal to them for them to fight and bleed for their country and then come back to a country, to a nation that would not give them the chance to be in a decent home, as might their white fellow citizens and white fellow soldiers. So that was his particular rationale. I'm sorry to say, and it's for somebody who has been a paper person all his life, I never kept a copy of that particular memo. What survives, and I'm glad it did, is the letter which then Congressman Bush wrote to me saying that he had decided to vote for the bill and that he was heading to a meeting in his district on the west side of Houston where he said he was being fitted for iron underpants in order to withstand the angry reaction from some of his constituents. It didn't matter politically, perhaps luckily because the filing deadline had passed. He was unopposed in the Republican primary. They couldn't do anything to him. And it was, you might say, a coincidence of both political luck and of high principle that made him not only survive that experience, but I think thrive from that experience. Yes, sir.
It seems like traditionally presidents have selected their vice presidents based on electoral votes and sometimes cynical purposes and so forth. With this modern vice presidency, do you feel the process of selecting a vice president has changed?
I do think that in the modern presidency, that an unofficial job description for a vice president is Hill experience required. And by coincidence, most all of our post-war vice presidents have served in the House or the Senate or both. The ones who've had the most trouble, incidentally, were former governors, Spiro Agnew and Nelson Rockefeller. Rockefeller, through no real fault of his own. At least he had worked with a legislative body quite a lot, having been governor of New York. But I do believe that the value a vice president with congressional experience, House and or Senate, brings to the White House is the ability to serve as the administration's most impactful, most persuasive lobbyist on Capitol Hill. And a former member of the House or Senate has a knowledge of the way those bodies operate. The House is often referred to as a fraternity, and the Senate like a club. And in fraternities and clubs, there are ways of doing things that George Bush knew, or for that matter, an Al Gore, an Ann Quayle, a Joe Biden happened to know, that magnifies the ability of a vice president to help the administration. Most interesting piece of real estate in Washington, apart from the West Wing, is Senate 212, which is a room off the Grand Senate Reception Lobby, which itself is off the Senate floor. Senate 212 is the ceremonial office of the Vice President in the Capitol. What it really is the only piece of the Capitol that is accessible and used all the time by members of the executive branch. It is the place that, since a vice president is both in the executive branch and the legislative branch, is able to host those members of the cabinet and other presidential appointees who are on Capitol Hill for one reason or another. And that dual role is magnified if the vice president does have Hill experience. I wrote something to this effect and sent it off to the Romney campaign in 2012. I do not claim that it made the difference, but I think the selection of Paul Ryan as Romney's running mate would have illustrated that. That is, if they had been elected, Paul Ryan, having been a House member, would have been able to help Romney, former governor who had never served in Washington, to be an effective president. And a converso, I think that a former governor who is vice president cannot bring the same knowledge to bear. Even though a governor might have worked with a legislature, dealing with legislators over the deer season is quite different from dealing with the Congress on matters of budget policy and other major legislation. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
I'm sure you have many of these, but anyway, I was curious what, I guess, because you were working with George Bush for 2 years, I think you had said, and I'm sure you have lots of memorable moments, but maybe a moment in your time there that really struck you, really had an impression, or just one of your favorite moments, I guess, working with, you know, Bush during those first years in the West Wing.
Yes, well, like anybody who's been in that world, I've got all kinds of anecdotes and memories. Perhaps the most special of all is mentioned in this book. I can drop the names of people like Margaret Thatcher, who hosted a dinner at number 10 Downing Street that I got to attend, and that's in the book, or a private audience with Pope, now Saint, John Paul II in the Clementina, Sala Clementina in the Vatican. That was very special. But perhaps the all-time special thing that's mentioned in great detail here was when Vice President Bush was on an official visit to Japan, and Emperor Hirohito held a lunch inside the Imperial Palace in Tokyo for him. And I was honored to be one of those also invited to that lunch. The book goes into the detail of the occasion, but that was very special because, like some of you who've had the chance to be in Tokyo, I had stood on the outside of the Imperial Palace looking up at those immense medieval walls surrounded by moat and wondered what could possibly go on inside that place. And on that particular day, nothing was more thrilling than to be in a motorcade that actually went across the moat onto the walls where there is another moat, and then into the main grounds of the palace. I have to say, I had to borrow the anecdote I'm about to tell you, but to me it was hilarious from that experience. And that is that during the luncheon, Barbara Bush sat next to Emperor Hirohito, and she recounted in her memoirs how difficult it was to have a conversation with him, not only because he did not speak English, but because he would only answer questions with monosyllables. It would be like yes, or no, or thank you. That was the entire conversation. So Mrs. Bush began running out of topics, and she looked around the beautiful and very modern room where we were lunching, and she said, this is a very beautiful room. And he said, yes. And she said, yes, it is quite beautiful, particularly the tapestry. And he said, thank you. And she said, it looks very new. And the emperor said, yes. And she said, he said, then added a phrase. He said, yes, it replaced an older one. And she thought, oh, we have a conversation going on here. And she said, oh, what happened to it? And the emperor smiled and said, I'm afraid you bombed it. That was the end of that conversation. So, all right, any other questions? Yes, Clyde.
The approach to Russia then compared to the approach to Russia now?
Well, it was a different period. This is where we should have Ambassador Durgin jump up and answer the question, since he was actually serving in Moscow in those very difficult and frigid days. And it was quite different because during the years mentioned in this book, we saw the transition from Brezhnev to Andropov. And that is described, that is the funeral in Moscow for Brezhnev, which George Bush attended on behalf of President Reagan. He had been, at the time, we were on a goodwill visit through Africa when word came of Brezhnev's death. The trip was stretched out to allow a chunk in between, in which we left Lagos, Nigeria, and flew first to Frankfurt and then on to Moscow for the funeral, then back to Africa to finish the trip. During the 1984 campaign in which Ronald Reagan ran for re-election, his opponent was Walter Mondale, and Walter Mondale said that Reagan was the first president of the United States since Herbert Hoover not to meet with his Soviet counterpart. This was an allegation to indicate how, Reagan was disconnected from trying to do anything about Soviet relations. Well, Reagan had the classic rejoinder. He said, well, they kept dying on me. And it is true that Brezhnev was succeeded by Andropov. Andropov lived about a year. He was succeeded by Chernenko. He lived about a year. And then he was succeeded by Gorbachev. That gets us into a different era. And on each of those occasions, it was George Bush, Vice President of the United States, who had the first meeting with the new Soviet leadership. No other delegate attending the obsequies in the Kremlin for the departed leader had the chance to make that, have that conversation. But Bush was there. And that, needless to say, was a very important set of dialogues. And it also pointed out that one of the things that comedians have made light of in recent years about the vice presidency, namely that vice presidents go to a lot of funerals, ignores the fact that funerals can be very valuable. A foreign funeral is not unlike a funeral for your great aunt, in which it's for the living and not the dead. And the benefit of being there amongst living people is that a lot of them are not only the new leadership of that particular country, but all the other leaders who attend the funeral. A CIA agent whom I knew said only half jokingly that George Bush put together the coalition that won the first Gulf War based on all the people he had met at all the funerals he had attended as vice president. But that's not being too far fetched in saying the benefit of all that. And I'd say all of that did help his own understanding and management of Soviet relations when he himself became president. Yes, please.
At the end of your talk, you mentioned that when we have another era of the presidency. Maybe some things will go right. What particular characteristics would you say this new presidency or these candidates coming up would? What really is the profile of a president and vice president to make things go right?
Well, the first thing, and I touched on earlier, is that such a president, I imagine, having had prior executive experience, either as a state governor or as a cabinet officer or as a vice president, but primarily in a job with line responsibility. A governor, and I'm not speaking of any particular governor when I say this, but I do believe that there is a transferable skill between a state house and the White House. Obviously, the scale is different, but they're very similar in that a governor, like a president, has to decide on budgets, has to decide on appointments, has to communicate policy, convince legislators and voters of what those policies are and should be, and generally manage the business of being the chief executive, of being the ultimate boss. Those are skills that you just do not learn on the job, and I do not mean to pillory our current president, but it's very clear that since Barack Obama had only been in the U.S. Senate, he lacked that particular knowledge of how to be an executive. Now, he had and has many great skills that he has brought to bear, but time and time again, we see that the lack of having been an executive and trained himself in those particular arts lead to all kinds of dismay, both legislatively and administratively. Again, my purpose is not to run down Barack Obama. It is just a fact. And I think that it may be, it's not just coincidence, that most of our recent presidents have been either governors or, in the case of Vice President Bush, an executive of a federal agency and Vice President of the United States. It may be that there is a certain gravitas, a certain leadership quality, skill set that comes from having been an executive, even if it's in a small state like Arkansas or Georgia. That, I think, will do a great deal to help create an era of progress defined as trying to get things done. I do believe the American people, regardless of ideology, expect their leaders to actually work, to get things done, to spend time on task. And that's why the histrionics of both parties in recent years, in which they think it's quite satisfactory for nothing to happen in order to prove a point or to skewer the other side, is destructive and definitely has done a great deal to draw the parties farther apart and to make it less likely for progress to be made. Progress, however you define it, from the left or the right. And I do believe that this situation is reparable. I'm an optimist when it comes to American government. I do believe that things that we get wrong, we can undo. But it does take leadership. And we saw that in the coming of Ronald Reagan. And it wasn't so obvious to those of us who hadn't supported him that he had those skills, that he truly knew how to lead and how to get things done in Washington. But he did. And if it happened before, it can happen again. And I am an optimist in that regard. Yes, Alan.
You mentioned the aspect of the personality and leadership just now and compromise. Do you see in the last 25 years changes within the system? And I'm mainly thinking of the accessibility of money, the need of money, capability of PACs, the way it's run, that have switched this ideological factor and maybe have supplanted the aspect of leadership and made some of these other areas more important, and maybe those systems need to be addressed and changed before we could reach the kind of conclusion we're all hoping for.
Well, the thing you mentioned, the increasing impact of money, not that it's been unimportant in our history. We can go back to the days of Mark Hanna raising money for William McKinley and probably whoever was running Andrew Jackson's campaigns. They probably grumbled about money in that era as well. But, of course, nothing approaching the magnitude of the hundreds of millions that are raised and spent in political campaigns today. You could also add our 24-hour news cycle and instant communications and a lot of other things that characterize our modern life and our modern politics. That is an egg that cannot be unscrambled. We have to live with it. But I also tend to think in the wisdom, an essential wisdom of politics that was spoken by a man who himself was not a politician. It was, in fact, he was sort of an anti-politician, and that was Henry Adams, who was of the great line of Adamses, a couple of which I made reference to earlier. Henry Adams said that politics consists of ignoring facts. This is something I quote to candidates quite a lot, when whatever the facts are, state, local, national, there's the other side has too much money, or the other side is too well known, or the other side is going to say nasty things about me, or maybe this is not the year to run. Whatever the facts are, and though there are not always wrongful facts, can be ignored by the plucky, the decisive politician. And that's the tale of success we've seen again and again in terms of political success, be it electoral success or passing a bill through the Congress, that if you ignore facts and just plow ahead, obviously with the skill set to ignore those facts successfully and communicate an alternate vision and to lobby enough people to get enough votes changed, you can surprise people. I just do believe that that is the essence of success in politics, is that degree of determination that comes from ignoring facts. Yes, please.
I've been worried for a long time about the debt and how China has bought our debt and what China will do next against the monetary system that we know now with the dollar. And do you think in the near future that there's any possibility of another currency coming in and taking the place of our dollar?
Well, you know what they say, that if you owe the bank $1,000, the bank owns you. And if you owe the bank $1,000,000, you own the bank. And that may well be the essential truth of this immense debt that we have with the Chinese. That is, yes, there probably are all kinds of financial mischief they could do with the vast numbers of dollars locked up in some vault in Beijing. But it's not in their interest to do it because, in effect, we own the bank in the case that to do that would be to destroy China's own sales in America, destroy a global economy in which they have learned to run by the rules. Nothing is immutable, so I suppose you could say that at some point people could not imagine that the British pound would ever be replaced by any currency, but for various historical and financial reasons we all know it was. But there is no other currency, certainly not the Chinese yuan at the moment, that could replace or supplant the dollar in international currency. Not that we aren't doing our best through our fiscal policies to weaken it and make that possible, but I don't think we'll see it. Please.
You spoke about Vice President Bush's efforts to become integrated into the Reagan staff. Can you speak about the transition of that Reagan staff into the Bush White House?
Yes, I'd be happy to talk about that. That will be the subject of book number 3. I should say that book number 2 will be published early next year by Texas A&M Press that carries my story into the Pentagon when I was an assistant secretary of the Navy, and that will be filled with all kinds of adventures of what it's like to be a civilian in a military institution. And it will also be a portrait of the two very remarkable secretaries of the Navy for whom I worked, John Lehman and Jim Webb. Jim Webb, later U.S. Senator from Virginia. Volume 3 will be the start of the Bush administration. It will, among other things, include the time I met Diana, because she was working for Boyden Gray, the counsel to the president. He, by the way, was the other person announced by President-elect Bush the day after the election, because the White House counsel, the president's lawyer, and the personnel director have to work so closely together. That's how I happened to meet Diana. But to return to your point, the experience of having been the personnel director, and who knows, I may have a chance to come back here in a couple of years at a similar forum and talk about that in detail. But the experience of being the personnel director is to be reminded of the uniqueness of that transition between Reagan to Bush, unique in the sense that it was the first intra-party transition of modern times. The previous intra-party transition was when Herbert Hoover succeeded Calvin Coolidge in 1929. Well, the federal government was so tiny in those days that truly Herbert Hoover, the new president, was acquainted with the assistant secretaries of the various departments. The White House staff was tiny, but he knew those people because he had been the Secretary of Commerce under the Harding Coolidge administrations. And therefore, it really had no relevance upon what happened 60 years later. There was a great deal of feeling on the part of many people who supported Ronald Reagan that George Bush fired all the Reagan people. You still hear this expression. It was quite untrue. There was, in fact, those were the people on whom the administration was built. And that's true in any administration. That is, the Obama administration reached back to the Clinton administration to get people to serve in various ranks, and the George W. Bush administration reached back to his father's and Reagan's administrations to get appointees. That just is the pattern of our national government. So it stands to reason that a George Bush would draw upon Reagan appointees of various kinds to fill his administration. We could go down the list, but it is quite lengthy, and it is, extends up and down the ranks. Nevertheless, there were people who did have to vacate their jobs, be it in the White House staff, that always turns over with the new administration, but also in the appointed ranks of the departments and agencies. There had been people, after all, who had worked for the election of George Bush. They had certain political credits that were redeemed by getting jobs, and you can't have two people in the same job, so somebody had to leave as a new person arrived. To the extent possible, we tried to accommodate those people, find out if they'd be interested in other positions. Some chose to leave and go into the private sector. Others might have been asked to go against their will, and if so, their grumbles were heard, and that powered this notion that you can still hear today from certain old-timers about Bush firing all the Reagan people. But that just wasn't true. Yes, you can get another one.
You don't mind?
Please.
I read a book last year called The Crusader by Paul Kilgore. I forget where he's a historian at, but it's basically all about Reagan's covert war on communism. And in the book, you know, the secret alliances he had with like the Pope and Margaret Thatcher and stuff that wasn't in the press, it was pretty interesting. But I guess one thing that I read in the book that I was really curious about, I wasn't sure if it was true, and here you are, so this is a great opportunity, was basically that there were times in Reagan's war against communism that he had to keep things even from his, or intelligence and stuff like that, even from his vice president, that he would have a very small circle that he would, that he met with, that at times he had to exclude Mr. Bush, basically because it could maybe mess up his plans or something like that. I'm just, and I hope I'm not misrepresenting the book at all, but I mean, that's the basic, you know, gist of what I got from it. So I'm curious if you know if any of that is true, or if there's any hint of that, or is that totally foreign and off the wall? What your take is on that?
Well, this is hard for me to answer because I was there for only 2 of 8 years. During the 2 years I was there, I was unaware there was anything along the lines of what you said. Now, as a denizen of Washington during the 1980s, as the Iran-Contra episode occurred, it was of embarrassment to George Bush because he said that all the goings-on by Oliver North to sell weapons to the Iranians and use the money to fund the Contras in Nicaragua were not known to him, that he was out of that loop. Well, I think that happened to be true. It was embarrassing because he was so involved in at least a higher level and a wide variety of other international issues that it would seem that he ought to have known. But the fact is that he was able to persuade people, both voters and Judge Walsh, the special prosecutor, that he was not culpable. After all, it was Colonel North's desire that nobody really know what he was doing, including Ronald Reagan, although he always made it seem like he had some special pass to get in the back door of the Oval Office and that he and the president would nod at each other and understand how that was to work. I don't believe it happened that way. The whole Iran-Contra moment was much more in the press than it was a genuine catastrophe to the administration. It was embarrassing, and it was definitely a heavy ball and chain during the last couple of years of that time. But you can look at the results. George Bush got elected president of the United States immediately afterwards, and the people who were most directly involved through one means or another were either pardoned by action of him or never were convicted of any particular crime. So it lives as a scandal in Washington more than it is a dire moment. Yes, please.
This may be the subject of your book 6 or 7, perhaps, your ambassadorship experience, and given what happened here a year or so ago in Benghazi, kind of what some maybe your personal reflections are about that situation and your time in Qatar.
Well, happily, Qatar is a benign place. It's still in a very dangerous neighborhood. I personally had protection from the Qatari government. It was particularly useful in navigating traffic in Doha, more than it was fending off any known attacks. There was a bombing during the time that we were living there, the only major terrorism act against Western interests in Qatar. It was a jihadi from Egypt who loaded up his Toyota Land Cruiser with a fertilizer bomb and rammed it into the rear of a community theater at a time a production of Shakespeare was being held. The director was killed. That was a great tragedy, but no one inside the theater was. So I never experienced anything like Ambassador Stevens. But from my brief experience there in the State Department, it would seem to me that underlying the tragedy of what wasn't done in Benghazi was not the result of any official making an act to deny security. I cannot imagine a piece of paper crossed the desk of Hillary Clinton, which was, shall we reinforce the consulate in Benghazi, yes, no, at which time Hillary Clinton drew a big X on the no. That doesn't happen that way. I could easily imagine, and maybe the subsequent hearings will reveal, that it was just, if you will, bureaucratic sloth in the Office of Overseas Buildings that led to the reinforcement or the building of a new security wall or compound in Benghazi was just not done that quickly. It also seems to me that Benghazi, after all, was considered a friendly place. It was where Ambassador Stevens had been resident for many months during the upheaval against Gaddafi. It was the center of opposition to Gaddafi. And what we also know is that the team that assaulted the consulate was a dedicated terrorist unit that took advantage of what they must have scoped out to be a weakened perimeter at the consulate. The other part that's coming into these discussions as to whether there could have been, should have been a stronger military presence there, I just don't know. I'm going to wait to hear what testimony there is. The Marines, who may or may not have been at the consulate, were there primarily to protect the classified. They will protect human beings if that is part of it, but for the most part, the Marine Security Guard details in embassies and certain selected consulates are there to protect the classified, and that may have been their primary concern. But as of the time, the assaulters who were armed with rocket-propelled grenades began to invade the compound and to set fire to buildings. It was highly doubtful that a rescue could have been mounted from as far away as where American forces were, which I think was in Italy. There were no naval units offshore anywhere close. So unfortunately, a 911 call would not have helped that particular situation. But say again, I wait to hear the results of the investigations. Mrs. Untermeyer.
Yes, Mrs. Untermeyer has some comments here. You know, Qatar is a very safe place, but being somebody without any protection and living in our residence, if anybody had wanted to do something, it would have been extremely easy. And a lot of my Qatari friends were very concerned about me just driving myself around and not having anything. Our embassy, as far as I can tell, the primary person, the embassy being the residence where the ambassadorial family lives, as far as I can tell, the primary person monitoring the perimeter wall was meant to be our chef, because there was a little television outside the kitchen. But the problem with that is it was usually snow. So I don't know who was watching. Now, maybe there was a feed that was going back to the actual where the office is and the Marines were, and somebody was monitoring it there. But it was certainly a very long way from the office to the residence. So, you know, there was a feeling amongst a lot of State Department people that money was being diverted from lots and lots of State Department things, all going into the green zone in Iraq. So, yes, Qatar is a very safe place. On the other hand, it's in a very dangerous neighborhood, and I think the security was woefully inadequate. And even now, in our new embassy, I noticed that the monitoring of the perimeter fence is again in the kitchen. So I guess for the benefit of Imad, our very wonderful chef.
Thank you, Ms. Untermeyer. One last question here, and then we'll all get to go home.
Yes, you know, in your personnel side of the deal, do you think that we've gone too much of having political appointees versus civil service for a little higher up the chain in the government, or do you think that, you know, we're successful and we'll continue to be successful with the relatively large amount of political appointees going into change of government?
I do believe that the line dividing political appointees from career civil servants needs to be higher. I do believe, having been a deputy assistant secretary and then an assistant secretary, the dividing line there is that while both can be political appointments, the assistant secretary is a position appointed by the president with the advice and consent of the Senate. And that probably is the correct place to draw the line. I would believe that deputy assistant secretary, which is sounds like one of those classic Washington titles, but it is clearly an important position where things happen or don't happen within the bureaucracy, could well be or should well be the kind of level to which any able civil servant ought to be able to aspire. During the Carter administration, there was created something called the Senior Executive Service, which was to be, as the name implies, the highest levels of civil service attainment. And it would seem to me that that job, Deputy Assistant Secretary, should be where a career civil servant should be able easily to attain appointment in an administration. That would give them the opportunity to show leadership and bring expertise to bear while still reporting to a political appointee who would reflect the mandate of the president. It also, no problem on my account, should allow civil servants to be appointed to presidential and Senate-confirmed positions. That happens all the time, such as distinguished Foreign Service officers who get to be ambassador. That could well be repeated in the domestic agencies as well. Well, once again, thank you all very much.